I am so excited about our next speaker because I've been binging on her video content, especially her TED talk about singing. And I am so excited to bring her to the stage. So Tania de Jong AM is a trailblazing Australian soprano, award-winning social entrepreneur, creative innovation catalyst, spiritual journey woman, storyteller, and global speaker. Tania is one of Australia's most successful female entrepreneurs and innovators, developing 5 businesses and 3 charities over the past 3 decades, including Creative Universe, Creativity Australia, and with one voice, Creative Innovation Global, Mind Medicine Australia, Dimension 5, MTA Entertainment and Events, Potpourri, and The Song Room. It just keeps going. And Tania's TED Talk, How Singing Together Changes the Brain, has sparked international interest. And Tania's mission is to change the world one voice at a time. Thank you so much, Tania and Amrit. Let's give them a warm welcome.
So listening to that laundry list of things you're accused of, you're not creative at all. No. Tell us a little bit about creativity.
Creativity. Yeah, look, it's one of those interesting words because people always say to me, what is the difference between creativity and innovation in particular? So all of us are creative. Is there anyone in this room actually at the moment who doesn't think that they're creative? Just put your hand up if you think that you're not creative. There's a lady at the back, yeah. Well, just come up for a moment, actually, if you don't mind. Sorry about this, but come on.
It's a reward for putting your hand up.
Give her a clap. Oh, there was another lady there too. Oh, she got it. That's right. Tell me your name. Brittany. Brittany, and why don't you think you're creative?
I don't know. I just can't think of any way that I'm creative. I don't really think I'm a very interesting or imaginative person, I guess.
And tell me what you do.
I just this week finished my occupational therapy degree.
Right. And do you solve a lot of problems?
I don't know. I get
for other people, and do you help them a lot?
Yeah.
Yeah, right. Is Brittany creative, ladies and gentlemen? Yeah. Yes. Thank you, Brittany. You can sit down now. So one of the mistakes that I think a lot of people make is they think that creativity is about the arts, you know, that it's about painting or drawing or doing ballet or something like that. And look, all of us have that capability, but creativity is also about solving problems. And I think everyone in this room, we're all leaders here. That's why we're here getting hacked and getting high, is because we actually want to do something in the world, and we want to create and contribute to this world, and we want a life of meaning and purpose. That's why we're probably all here today, yeah? So all of us are creative, solving problems. Now, innovation is the next part of that stage. So creativity, coming up with lots of different ideas, solving problems, and then innovation is turning those ideas into something of value, which doesn't have to be of commercial value. It could be of social value. And social value is exactly what we need right now in a world of increasing social and economic problems. So anyway.
Yeah, that segues totally into social enterprise and a lot of the stuff that's going on. Yeah. I really love what you're sharing, because the journey of the inspired evolution, it's not about me, but I was on the journey where the podcast started was I was in corporate 9-to-5 working as an engineer for a really long time, right? And I'd realized that I'd indoctrinated myself to becoming an engineer, and I, like Brittany, thought I wasn't creative. I was like, I'm a numbers person, physics, right? And that kind of, I saw that there was all these people that were speakers, thought leaders, and people that were living in a space that really inspired me. When I went to see these people, they created such a shift inside me that I was like, these people are creative. And I went on the journey of, okay, I'm going to create a podcast. What's it about? And the podcast is about me basically interviewing creatives and entrepreneurs so that I can tap into living a creative life as an entrepreneur. And I just want to flag that one thing I commonly find myself saying is that I don't see them as being any different. Like a creative and an entrepreneur. Oh,
absolutely.
They're the same thing, right? You, as an entrepreneur, you just got creative about how you made your money. Yeah, that's legitimately all it is. It's like you're still a creative, yeah?
Yeah, and that question, you know, that we can all ask, what could be happening that's not happening right now, that what if question. Would you like me to just tell everyone a little bit about my grandmother?
Sure.
Yeah, so my grandmother was an incredibly creative person. She was an artist back in the 1920s, and she lived in Vienna. Her and my grandfather were Polish emigres who'd come to study with the great sculpture teacher Anton Hanek. He was a contemporary of Egon Schiele and Gustav Klimt. So you can imagine Vienna in the 1920s, right? The beautiful architecture, the buildings,
very polished.
The community was very loving and friendly between the two wars there. And my grandmother and grandfather fell in love as young art students, and one particularly rainy Sunday, like today actually, my grandmother was walking along. She said to my grandfather, you know, what if someone was to invent a little umbrella? I'm always leaving my umbrella behind, my big tall umbrella behind in the cloakroom. And what if someone was to make an umbrella to fit in a handbag? And she said, let's keep this a secret between us. And so they kept it a secret, and my grandmother went round, you know, the old lampshades that there used to be with all the spokes, and she went round all the shops in Vienna getting the old spokes of the lampshades. And she tried and failed with her idea many times. And I like to think of fail as first attempt in learning. Because you can see my grandmother's notes. You know, I tried this today. It didn't work. But tomorrow I'm going to try this. So she never gave up. And that really is a secret of entrepreneurship and creativity, is going through that fear of failure. So she tried and failed with her idea for about 6 months. We have her working notes. And then in September 1929, she invented the very first foldable umbrella, which is called the Flirt. Which I think is a really cute name for a little umbrella. And it was patented and manufactured for the next 10 years in an Austrian factory. It's still actually manufactured in that same factory today. But in 1939, the Nazis came into Vienna, and my family is Jewish. And I don't have time to tell you today the full story of what happened to them. But, of course, I'm very lucky to be here today at all, because most of the rest of my family were taken away and perished during the Holocaust. So what happened was, when she managed to escape to Switzerland, the German authorities contacted her and said, Mrs. Dordig, we believe you have the first foldable umbrella patent. We'd like to buy it from you. Well, my mum was only 3 months old at the time, so she had no choice but to sell her patent. And, of course, we were never to see another sent from that invention, which is why I have to work today. No, no.
But, well, it's good. It made you creative.
Yeah, but she still does hold the patent. So if you look in the global patent registry, you'll see my grandmother Slava Horowitz, and you'll see that she holds a patent in a number of European countries for the foldable umbrella. And some of you probably, who's got an umbrella here today? Right, there you go. We'll just think of Nana. I'm
one
sure it's foldable.
In Melbourne, only one person carried a... Wow.
So fail, first attempt in learning. You know, none of us have ever succeeded at anything without failing multiple times, right, Amrit?
I think that's a really beautiful, beautiful thing that you're sharing, in terms of, for a long time I've been exposed to this idea that failure does actually, like, lead to success. Everyone's like, fail better, fail harder, keep failing. And like the hippie in me is like, but I don't want to call failure in, like, that just sounds stupid. But I'm really in a place at the moment where it's taken about 3 years of sitting with this and really coming to realize that actually those are my best lessons. Yeah. I'm definitely not inviting it in. Still got some work to do in around there. But in terms of, oh, That's where I, pardon my French, ate some shit. That's really where I learned how to not do that again, you know. And yeah, there's some real sweet medicine in there.
Our greatest learning is when we, you know, have the hardest times, as you know, has been talked about today. It's when you hit that wall, you feel that terrible sense of anxiety. Am I good enough? Has anyone in this room ever felt they're not good enough? Hands up, right? You know, and we're all here today, and we've all pushed through that. And every time you hit that wall, that's an opportunity for growth. Huge opportunity.
Right. So is failure intrinsic to the creative process?
I believe the failure is totally intrinsic to the creative process.
Right.
You know, okay. A bit where you go, I'm rubbish, this is shit, it's never going to get any better. And, you know, that's where some entrepreneurs do and others give up.
Mm.
But it's, if we just push through, the gold is on the other side. I don't just mean monetary gold, by the way. It's gold in growth, self-growth.
Yeah, I think it's really potent coming from you, especially with the amount of work you've put into your voice and singing and hearing that, like, firsthand, that failure is such an intrinsic part to really developing and honing on your craft.
Yeah. Well, you know, and I was told that I should never bother to have singing lessons. So just very briefly, when I was 14, I wanted to have singing lessons, and my best girlfriend started having lessons, and I was a pretty busy kid, lots going on. And I went round to her house after school one day and said, can I learn the song that she'd been learning at singing? Because I was really jealous that she was having singing lessons, I wasn't. So she could play the piano, and we sang the song that she'd been learning a few times over. And then she said, I'll play the piano, you sing on your own. She played, I sang, and at the end of the song she said, Tania, you should never bother having singing lessons, you're not good enough. When I was 14, I believed her. Who got told stuff like that, right? Not about singing, could be about creativity, could be about anything. And so then I did backstage in the school musical because I thought, well, at least I can do the props. And then finally in year 11, I auditioned for the chorus of the musical Oklahoma. And to my amazement, I got the lead role. And that was really a defining moment in my life. And I realized that you should never let anyone snatch your dream away. If you really want to do something, we talked about this already a lot this morning, just go and do it. Don't let anyone snatch your dream away.
I think that's really potent. And just to flag, like, one of the things I've learned on the Inspired Evolution is that our biggest challenges always form our biggest gifts. The two people that I noticed put their hands up when people said, who's been told they don't sing or they're both creative, are the two people that are actually running a sound journey this evening for us in Get High. So, you know, these challenges are real, you know, and having to bust through them and then the blessings that await us on the other side is totally amazing. There's another piece to creativity which I'm not going to be able to do it justice, so I can't wait for you to talk about it, is this whole idea around random collisions. How do you describe
positive it? Positive human collisions.
Oh.
You know, we tend to hang out with people who are just like us, right? Dress like us, similar educational backgrounds, think like us, similar financial backgrounds often. Yeah, would you agree?
Yo,
let's make a bit of noise here. But our greatest gains as human beings are when we connect with people who are really different from us. And Steve Jobs famously said, creativity is simply just connecting the dots. But you can only connect the dots when you've got a bit of a creative toolbox. And how do you get that toolbox? You have a set of rich life experiences. You get that set of life experiences through connecting with people who are very different from you, who challenge you, who maybe disagree with you, who, boy, do they make you feel uncomfortable. But it's in that moment when you experience what's called creative abrasion and you feel that discomfort that really true creativity and innovation can spark. And I like to call that positive human collisions. And one of the things I'd love to do today is challenge each of you. You've probably maybe come with a friend or something like that, but I want to challenge you each to, in the breaks, connect with two or three people that you haven't met before. Connect with an alien and you'll find out just how much we have in common with one another. But also in that moment of connection, who knows what collaboration might occur? Who knows what new enterprise or new activity you're going to create with that person who you've never met before? So can I challenge you all, and will you take that up in the lunch break?
Can I get a yeah? you for the challenge accepted?
Big yo.
So in that, you're speaking to diversity, which yeah. I think is, yeah, it's obviously growing up Indian in a Western culture speaks to me really deeply. But I think one thing that I've noticed, especially with the world of social media, and I know that I'm just like harping a horn that everybody's tooting at the moment, which is that we end up being a little bit, and this is what you're articulating, in our own little self-affirming bubble, right? Like I'm even here at Get High, like we're all of a certain inclination. We want to all get high on our own supply, right? We're not out hitting the booze and we're just looking for good, clean fun. So we're a certain type of people. What it can be challenging, like in some part, some one level in today's society, it's really hard to find our own tribe.
Yeah.
Yeah. But on the same token, you're also encouraging us to then find people that are outside of our tribe to also encourage a certain mindset or?
Yeah. So it is like we're all looking for our tribe. In a sense, there's a tribe here because we are all here, you know, embracing today, and we obviously all believe in what in a path of personal growth. But stepping beyond that to people who are, for example, less fortunate than you is particularly beneficial. So I think all of us in this room are probably included. Would you agree that most of you are included in society? You've got homes, and probably most of you have jobs, yeah? But, you know, like reaching out beyond you to people who are less fortunate, there's incredible gift in that. By reaching out a hand, building a bridge with people who are less fortunate than you and actually being able to help them. Because it's amazing, like the tiniest little bit of help for someone who's less fortunate than you can change their lives. And I've done that particularly through my With One Voice choirs program. So we have these choirs where we connect people like all of us in this room, haves with have-nots, people who are migrants, job seekers, people with depression and disabilities who are alone and isolated. We have this massive crisis of loneliness and depression and social isolation, which we've talked about. And by reaching out to people who are less fortunate in these choirs, we come together about 50-50, so 50% haves, 50% have-nots. We sing together, but we also have a wish list. And through the wish list, people in our choirs can make wishes to one another for what they need in life, which could be, you know, help with accommodation, finding a friend, someone to walk to the station with, help them get a job, help with their resume. And people put up their hands in the choirs to help people with their wishes. And by the way, not only unfortunate or disadvantaged people have wishes, we all need stuff. You know, we might need someone to mow our lawn or mind our house or walk our dog. So in the choirs, we've had more than 3,500 wishes granted across all our choirs around Australia. We have 25 choirs in 7 states around Australia, which are much more than choirs. Yeah, we sing together, we share supper, and we help make people's wishes come true. And we connect people to one another who would have never thought that they'd be friends. So, yeah, we need this tribe, but outside of our tribe, we can make friends with really diverse people. And if you look at the people that come to my house, they're not all like me. They're so different. They're all different ages. And that's another gift is going beyond generations and really doing that, you know, reverse mentoring that all of us can learn from people younger than us and older than us and create amazing communities that are really diverse. And I guess I urge people to just go outside their own tribe and connect to other tribes and build bridges, not walls and boxes. We all tend to have so many walls and boxes between us as human beings, walls around our heart. We're looking at boxes all the time, our phone, our screens. You know, we're buying little boxes from the supermarket. We're always having to tick boxes on forms and stuff like that. But building those bridges, going beyond the boxes is huge.
I love that. I love how it encourages both openness and also can, you know, I can see how it can cultivate a level of resilience as well. This whole idea of building community beyond what is
it's safe
into,
for you.
Yeah,
what is safe
into
for you?
Diversity.
Yeah.
So one of the things you talked about singing, which I loved this when you shared this in your TED Talk, by the way, guys, check out the TED Talk. Amazing. So in there, you mentioned that singing actually had a biological evolutionary advantage. So who here likes singing?
Yeah. Love this group. Yo! Oh my God, I love it.
So we're in good company. And for those that don't, well,
10 years here, so by the end of the day, you're going to love it.
So, yeah, tell us, like, can you unpack that for us?
Yeah, so tribes have sung and danced together to build strength and ward off their enemies since, you know, time immemorial. And if you go to places like in the South Pacific or Africa, you see tribes singing and dancing together. But we somehow in the West have become really precious about this, like unless we're really good. And then we don't sing in front of other people. We just sing in the shower or in the car or something. But the research shows that when we sing with other people, we literally become smarter, healthier, happier, more creative. Our memory, language, and concentration improves. Our brains become neuroplastic. Our neural pathways start to connect in new and different ways. And it literally gets us high. So it takes us into a mind-altered state. And when we sing with other people, we get into this right-brained headset, I guess, call it right-brain, creative side of our brains, which is the right side of our brain is our human battery charger. It's responsible for our creativity, intuition, imagination. It connects us to one another and all that is. But unfortunately, we spend about 85% of the time in the left side of our brains being overwhelmed by too much information. Who feels overwhelmed by all the info, yeah, and all the devices and all the stuff coming at us? And we're literally draining our batteries. So we have to renew our batteries by getting in the right creative side of our brains. And there's lots of ways to do that. Singing is one, meditation's another, walking our dogs, cuddling our loved ones, going into nature. And, you know, another one that I'm particularly passionate about is plant medicine. So plant medicine, while not legal, I still feel like I've started a charity with my husband who's here today called Mind Medicine Australia. And it's really important for us all to connect back to ancient wisdom, plant medicine, singing wisdom, you know, all these different kinds of intelligences so that we can raise our consciousness collectively to solve these growing challenges that we're facing.
Yeah, I really love what you're sharing there in terms of like the ancient wisdom, and what's precipitating for me is like what is natural is...
Yeah, what is natural is high and hacked.
Is always, yeah, is what's best for us, you know, yeah. So this whole conversation.
If you want to get hacked and get high... Do all the natural stuff.
Find all the natural
plants,
things.
Plants, singing, loving.
Go to bed when the sun goes down, you know, and it's like, what is life telling you? You're feeling uncomfortable? Well, get back into alignment and swim in the lane that, you know, you were meant to.
So, yeah, I find that really poetic, and it reaffirms, like, one of the standpoints I have on life is that we are just the universe looking in on ourselves.
We are just.
The universe looking in on ourselves, right?
Yeah.
We fold it in. And so I feel like curiosity is innate to this human experience, right? But what are we here? Like the universe is created and we're here to create because we're the mirrors of the universe or whatever you want to call it, right? So the creativity is innate to this human experience. And I find it, yeah, even like Brittany, when she was saying, look, I'm an OCT therapist, you know, it's like, yeah, but you created that life, right? Like you went out of your way to going, hey, I'm going to choose this. I'm going to go do that. And then I'm going to, you know, like figure this out. These are going to be my friends. This is what I'm going to wear to get hacked and get high. You know, there's all those little pockets in there. I think that's really amazing. In terms of expressing creativity, you got a song for us?
Am I what?
You got a song for us?
A song? Would you like a song?
Come on again. Do we want a song?
Okay, well, look, just a little intro before I do this song then. Ash, I'll give you a cue in a sec, but just not quite yet. So I think that for all of us, we often search for love and learning and healing outside of ourselves, right? We're searching externally quite often, but the greatest gift is going inwards and finding that place within us where everything is possible, which is what you said, turning in to ourselves, because we have everything we need and we can create anything that we can visualize. So in this song, I'm going to encourage you at the start to close your eyes and listen to the lyrics and also to find that place within yourself of forgiveness. Because a lot of us, you know, we feel shame or embarrassment about a whole lot of things in our lives, but actually if we forgive ourselves and forgive the people who perhaps have wronged us, then we can go into that place of full heart-centeredness. So I want you to do that. But then at a certain point in this song, I'm going to ask you to join hands with the people all around you so we can create this human bridge, because it's through this human bridge coming together as a community, as a tribe, that we can create power and we can step up and we can meet the challenges that are facing us as a community. So I'm going to hold hands with you and everyone else around us. But so we can hit the track now, my friend, and we'll go into this space. So if you go into that place of meditation and stillness and connect deep within yourself, and you'll find that place of learning and caring and loving and sharing and forgiveness that lies deep within. There's a place for us, somewhere a place for us, peace and quiet. Holding hands to someone in the room, holding hands, joining hands.
Evolution back to getting hacked with Tania de Jong. Tania, it is such a treat to be here for round two. For those tuning in, you're listening to this in a long sequential piece, but this is actually round two. Welcome back.
Thank you, Amrit.
And just as an honor back to, you know, for those perhaps tuning in halfway through the episode, again, pardon me for the chop suey nature of this. Tania is an inspirational speaker, singer, businesswoman, and social entrepreneur, loving her social entrepreneur ventures. And she's founded a number of successful businesses. So it's great to have you back. Quick refresher, we've been talking a little bit about diversity and a little bit about creativity. A big reason why I was excited to have you back was because we had like a 5-minute chat about creativity, and I just don't think that does you any service or any justice knowing how creative you really are and how much it really means to you. So great to have you back. How are you?
Good. It's an honor. Absolutely.
Pleasure is mine. So
We were talking a little bit just before we got started in terms of, you know, the importance of like creativity and then like how that potentially weaves in with mental health awareness and stuff like that. So one of the key things I wanted to just, you know, like let's hit the ground sort of running. One of the biggest challenges in my life that I've had was that I struggled with depression for 6 years, right? And that depression over time, you know, and this links in well to the first part of the episode because we actually talked about how our greatest challenges form our greatest gifts. And in that, I was talking, so now like just sharing that the biggest challenge being depression for me and then learning how to learn and navigate my way through that and how mindfulness has really helped and meditation has completely reconstituted my life. Existential philosophy from that point, wisdom has helped me reconstitute my whole life to live in, and I touch wood, feel very happy inside, you know, and depression is like this like thing that is now in my past. Now, I'm very grateful that it's in my past, but one of the things that I learned along the way about depression was actually when I was depressed, I was keeping to myself, I was locking down, and I was actually deep, like the energy was like to depress, like to push down. Ooh. And then using like actually realizing that, oh no, I need to express, like I actually, that's just the opposite of my depression in many ways, is just the expression. Can I learn to express? Can I learn to connect? Can I learn to share? Can I learn to say my piece? Because I remember I was so trapped and so alone in feeling that actually this is how I feel. And in some ways I thought that's how the whole world felt at the same time when I was depressed. You know, I thought like everybody was running around trapped in their own mind, in their own being, in their own spirit, not really being able to communicate, you know, what was going on to the rest of the world, just because, and I thought that was everybody's battle and that I was somehow alone in having my own battle. But then at the same time, everybody else had their own battle. So that was normal until I went and got diagnosed with depression. They were like, actually, it's not entirely normal. But then normal is a whole other conversation. So the space for creativity and how it can help with mental health illness, I think, is a really yummy pocket to have a conversation.
Mm-hmm. Go on.
I was going to ask you, how did this first become your part of your awareness that mental health and creativity are like interlinked and interwoven?
Because I think I've always been a very creative person. So I've used expression to really help get me through a lot of life's obstacles.
Mm.
So whether that's, you know, breakup of a relationship or the passing of someone you deeply care about or a lot of change, and change, let's face it, is the only game in town. Mm. And we all have to be able to be resilient enough to manage constant ups and downs and curveballs that get sent in our direction. So that ability to pivot, to change direction when you realize that things are not working how you thought they were going to work,
mm.
but also that ability to cope with failure. So I think I might have mentioned in our first conversation that I like to think of fail as first attempt in learning.
I love that. That is so bad. I'm stealing that. That is so good.
Yeah, so, and I think I did talk about my grandmother who invented the very first foldable umbrella.
Yeah.
And she really went through, you know, trying and failing many times with her invention. But essentially, you know, when you're feeling down and your energy is flat, and you're really in a lower energy, in a lower vibration. And so it's incredibly important then to start using your creative voice in whatever ways. And we all have a creative voice. I mean, there's lots of people who think that they're not creative, but in fact, we were all born creative. You know, Picasso famously said we're all born as artists.
Mm.
The challenge is to remain as artists as we grow up, because there's so many things in our environment that oppress us and compress us and push our energies down.
Depress them down.
Yeah, so yeah, that's right. So our greatest challenge in a way and the greatest opportunity is to raise our energy and our consciousness so that we can actually learn to express ourselves and find our true voice, because all of us have a creative voice and all of us have a unique voice that matters in the global conversation. Mm. And so here we are, we're living in this time where loneliness and social isolation and depression are considered the global epidemic of our times.
Mm.
there are more and more people who feel like their voices don't matter, who feel depressed by all of the different social and economic challenges which are hitting us in every kind of way. And then not only, and combined with that, we also have this, these four other things that are really making life very tough. And they are, you know, the pace and accelerating technology. So the pace of change, the acceleration of technology, mm-hmm. which are just frightening in their own ways. There's opportunities as part of those new technologies, but they also are so fast that a lot of people can't keep up with the change.
Well, we're actually not anticipated to keep up with the change, right? Because they were mapping the growth of technology and it actually fits an exponential curve to a T. So it's actually perfectly exponential. But the challenge that they're having is, it goes all the way up to an asymptote at 2027, and now they're having to hypothesize what it means at 2027. And some of the greatest minds are now thinking that perhaps this is where our consciousness melts with artificial intelligence. That's I really don't know the answer, but these are some of the theories.
Like Ray Kurzweil, for example.
Oh, what a mind. Yeah.
Yeah, you know, that in 2029, that will, the singularity will occur where basically, you know, technological intelligence will exceed human intelligence. At that point, will merge with technology. So that in itself is certainly a challenge for humanity.
Yeah,
it's a challenge for humanity.
And then talk about staying dynamic. Yeah, I get it.
And then when you add to that, you know, uncertainty around the future of work. So a lot of people, you know, feel like, well, is my job even going to exist? You know, what am I going to do? How am I going to support my family? And, you know, we're seeing a lot of people who are in their late 40s, 50s who already are starting to feel, well, not only they're being made redundant, they're starting to feel redundant. And that in itself creates depression and anxiety. Then you combine that with climate anxiety. So we're seeing, you know, children as young as 8 to 10 who are actually experiencing climate anxiety. Some of them are being therefore medicated with antidepressants and other, you know, Western medicines.
Yeah.
Now, for a young developing brain, that is an enormous challenge. You then combine that with social media so that, you know, many people, you know, live their lives on social media and they're portraying elements of their life that is not actually real, right? So they're putting up, they're putting on social media what they want the world to see about them, which could be, you know, how beautiful they are or the holidays they're on or that they're very happy and they've got lots of friends and lots of material possessions and all these sorts of things. But actually, underneath it all, many of those people are actually very sad, depressed and lonely inside. And so that's only one form of expression. It's not the full, you know, expression of a human being. We all have so many facets and we have a rich tapestry, and it's natural for a human being anyway to go up and down and to experience all these different emotions. And unfortunately what happens, of course, is, you know, when you experience depression, you know, you're often then given medications that actually dampen those emotions. So they actually flatten the emotional spectrum. But that doesn't necessarily allow you to live as an emotional human being, which is essentially what we are. Like, we're not just flat and one-dimensional. You know, we have many dimensions. And so we need to actually be able and allowed to experience those different dimensions that make us truly human. And if we're given substances that flatten our emotions, then we're going to remain in our lower energies. That means it's going to be very hard for us to actually express ourselves, because when we're flattened out, it's hard for us to actually experience the highs and the lows. And actually, it's often the lows that create, for many people, the greatest creativity, that inspire that creativity. If you think about it, you know, many of the great songs that have been written and other works of art have been created from a feeling of depression and sadness. And that's where we often find our true creativity resides. So it's coming through that. And really, when I say through that, it's actually going into the darkness and embracing that. And you know, there's a famous saying that whatever is in the way is the way.
Mm.
And so, you know, we actually have to go right into the middle of that storm rather than thinking, oh, well, we can just go around the outside and we can avoid it and we don't have to feel bad. We don't have to experience the grief and the sadness of what it is to be human, as well as the joy and, you know, and the love and all the other wonderful things that make us human.
Mm.
So going into the eye of the storm, in a sense, then coming through that to the light.
Yeah.
Rather than feeling like, oh, well, let's avoid it and let's medicate ourselves, you know.
Yeah, no, I appreciate what you're saying. And there is...
And the other thing about that, sorry, Amrit, if I might just mention one other really frightening statistic is that, you know, at the moment it's 1 in 5 of us are experiencing a serious mental illness. 1 in 8 of us are on antidepressants, with 1 in 4 older adults on antidepressants and many younger people on antidepressants. So that those figures have increased by 95% in the last 15 years.
Yeah.
And it's estimated that 1 in 2 of us will experience a serious mental illness in our lifetimes.
Mm-hmm.
So we're like in this absolute pandemic of mental illness.
And it's surprising that we don't talk about it as much as we do.
Right. Exactly. So we need to talk about that. We need to talk about ways that we can create a community and solutions where we can actually find and use our caring nature as human beings. Because at heart, I think most of us actually are social animals.
Hmm.
And when I say that, not social media animals. And we want to actually connect with people. We want to touch them. We want to have conversations like the one we're having now that really is meaningful, because that gives us a sense of contribution and connection. And the reason why most of, you know, these statistics are so frightening is that people are feeling more and more disconnected. They don't feel part of anything anymore. They don't feel a sense of meaning and purpose. And they're playing out their lives on social media, but it's unreal. It's not actually anything that's truly meaningful. And so we need to work out what bringing back community and family and a sense of connection is really about, and how we can use ancient wisdom and ancient modalities to bring us back to ourselves and to really connect with others and our planet so that we can feel a sense of purpose and service. And service too. Service is also very important, because it can get very selfish in that social media world.
I think it's I think it's really fascinating to see just, you know, the conversation go from creativity through to connection, through to wisdom, and then through to service. You know, I think it's really profound, just the narrative that followed that, the response that you gave, you know, because it's like, you know, we get creative, and I never really sort of looked at it so poignantly, but creating connections, right, is like a, it's like a form of creativity, right? And so you actually create the connections, the connection to the self and everyone else has that collective wisdom.
And the planet too. And the planet is so right now.
And so one thing that sticks out for me poignantly in what you were sharing was that, you know, we can, and especially because of my story, I'm not sure how much of this I've shared with you, but I, when I got diagnosed with depression, I basically, by some grace of God, got given two options, and one of them was this breathing exercise, which was literally breathe, and my doctor got that, and my psychologist, she gave me pills. She was just like, here's a bunch of pills. And I remember looking at the breathing exercise and looking at the doctor and going, breathing, like, I've been doing this for, you know, 20 years. I'm good. Like, I don't need to breathe more. Like, I do this, you know, and I completely dismissed it. And I remember going home, taking my first pill, having an amazing time, legitimately just like, you know, it was basically these pills, many of them have, are synonymous with methamphetamines, right? So you're on a high, right? and you get this high, you're amazing for 4 hours, 6 hours, and then you crash. And yeah. I remember coming on my first crash and I was like, whoa, like what is happening? Like I feel worse than when I first took it. And that moment I realized I looked at the box and I literally just picked up the box and put it in the bin. Mm-hmm. It's just like, I can't do this. Like I know that this was prescribed to me and this is the mental solution, but this is not the solution because I can't spend the rest of my life going up and down and up and down and up and down. I don't believe in this. I don't subscribe to this, you know? And I carried on forward without a solution basically, because mind you, I totally like discarded the breathing the minute it got given to me. And I remember being in an anxiety provoking environment a couple of weeks away from being diagnosed. And I legitimately had like in my phone, somehow in the back cover of my phone, I had slipped in the breathing exercise facing outwards. And it's interesting we talk about connection, because what I used to do, I didn't realize this, but I would basically call people and just have 30-minute chats with them when I was like feeling tense or something. It'd be like, oh, I just search for someone. I just call them, not actively being aware that, oh, I'm in an anxious situation. I need to call someone. That was just my response. Like I would just be like, oh, yeah, I could easily spend 30 minutes on the phone with someone connecting to them, which obviously was facilitating my journey through the anxiety, through that connection to a friend or a loved one. But when I pulled out my phone and I saw this breathing exercise on the back of my phone, I was just like, oh, okay. And I just tried it. I just breathed in. One, breathed out. Two, breathed in. Three. And it was amazing just feeling everything just soften, dissolve. And I was just exercising mindfulness, but it was my first time ever in the height of my anxiety. And depression and anxiety are heavily linked like this, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And so it was like a really profound moment for me that actually was available. And so, and again, mindfulness and meditation, exactly what you shared, like ancient practices, right? Making a mistake. Because these challenges that we face throughout time have been addressed before through these amazing modalities, right?
Well, that's right. People didn't have an epidemic of anxiety and depression in ancient times, you know. And as we said in our original conversation, they also sang and danced together to ward off their enemies and build strength. So this is part of our human DNA. And if we drop these particular practices, and become so distracted, then we have no center anymore. It's not surprising that we feel completely overwhelmed and, anxious.
And so in that, like I'm mindful because you said, those pills, they flatten your energies out, because
not to mention the side effects.
Oh, that's like a whole nother kettle of fish. Yeah. you're mentioning that these pills, like they flatten out your energies. But then there's a whole space of work that you're doing with like one of your charities, which you set up with your husband called Mind Medicine Australia, which is about taking medicines that can then support your journey through the mental health arena.
That's right. Yes.
Tell us more about that.
Yeah, so my husband, Peter Hunt, and I set up Mind Medicine Australia. We launched it in February 2019. So it's relatively new, but it's really all about making sure that psychedelic medicines, which have been achieving extraordinary results in FDA trials for treatment-resistant depression, anxiety, post-traumatic stress disorder, and addiction, are available to those who are suffering. So at the moment we have the situation where these medicines are classified in Australia as Category 9, which is, of no value and dangerous, which is completely untrue because they're completely non-toxic. Mm-hmm. So we're talking about particularly the medicine psilocybin, which is the psychoactive component of magic mushrooms, and MDMA, which are being used in psychedelic-assisted psychotherapy in universities and hospitals all over the world with extraordinary outcomes. Like we're seeing 60 to 80% remissions from just 2 to 3 doses of these medicines versus potentially a lifetime of antidepressants and all their side effects, or a lifetime of psychotherapy, which is repetitive and very costly, and most people don't stick with it. The other thing about antidepressants is their remission rates are actually very, very low. So as you experienced, their response rate may be, initially high, but then they drop away and people experience a lot of relapse. And for a lot of people, they don't have any remission or response from the antidepressants. So we're seeing that more and more, so that people are not getting better, which is why we have these statistics. You know, the statistics that we have at the moment is because people are actually not getting better. Hmm. And more and more people are writing to us every day, emails, letters, calling us, just begging us to provide them with these medicines, which, of course, we can't do at the moment because they're not legal. But what we are doing is we're making sure that we can work with the regulators and we can educate and build awareness about these medicines so that people understand how incredibly, effective they are in the treatment of these illnesses. And what's incredible as well, Amrit, is that we're now seeing these medicines being trialled for not only those common mental illnesses, but now they're being trialled for, you know, anorexia and eating disorders, obsessive compulsive disorders, alcohol and smoking addiction, and now early stage dementia as well. Mm. So it's pretty remarkable. And what's important to note, though, is that these medicines have been around since ancient times. And in many cultures, they're used as healing modalities and have been since time immemorial. Mm-hmm. And in the 50s and 60s, over 40,000 patients were treated with psychedelic medicines to heal a whole range of conditions. And they were considered the next big thing in psychiatry. So, unfortunately, what happened was in 1970, President Nixon was wanting to conscript a whole lot of people into his Vietnam War effort. Mm-hmm. And he couldn't attack the blacks and the hippies as a group, so he used the drugs. And by criminalizing the medicines, he was able to attack the leaders of the blacks and the hippies put them in prison and all these sorts of things if they didn't conscript. Right. And unfortunately, you know, all these years later, it's quite ridiculous. Like we're heading into 2020 now, 50 years it's been that these medicines have been suppressed and research funding stopped. Now, fortunately, what's happened now is there's a renaissance of interest in these medicines. And we're seeing studies, over 100 trials currently worldwide. Mm. And these medicines are likely to be prescribable in the next 1 to 2 years.
Amazing. And so I'd love to thank you so much for sharing so much on that with such eloquence as well. So one of the questions that arises for me is, what was your inspiration behind establishing, like, obviously there's all these challenges that we're facing, you know, and mm-hmm. I think there's so many people that can see these challenges, like such as myself, you know, like I can see all these stats to depression and anxiety, which has me traveling around the world delivering mindfulness seminars, meditation seminars, just because I don't want anybody to have to go through what I went through. You know what I mean? Like that's like my key number one focus, and hence the Inspired Evolution does the work that it does. And my query then is, you know, like what was your inspirations behind creating such an amazing charity, right, with such foresight and, you know, such, I'm just going to have to call it bravery, you know, because like you said, it's like it's not necessarily what is accepted at the moment, but you've taken the courage to then, you know, with the awareness that, you know, this is actually something that can help people. Was there some part of, has there some been some part of your journey or Peter's journey that, you know, you've struggled with anxiety, depression?
There's two reasons. One was that we have set up four other charities before this one between us. And, you know, and you can provide programs and like the one we spoke about before, Creativity Australia and the With One Voice program, definitely heals a lot of people through the singing and the mindfulness that creates. Mm. But at the end of the day, and Peter's set up women's community shelters for homeless women, and we've set up other charities as well. I set up the Song Room, which brings music and arts to disadvantaged children. He's the chairman of So They Can, which is another incredible charity that works in, you know, third world countries, providing education to very poor people. But at the end of the day, at the base of disadvantage, if you look at it, you can provide all these programs doing all these different things. But if at the base a person is suffering from some kind of mental illness or anxiety or trauma, that is sitting there and it's undealt with. So you can do any number of programs,
yep,
but the person is not necessarily going to heal because you're not dealing with the root cause,
mm-hmm,
of what's making them disadvantaged to begin with.
Right.
So the program you provide may help them a bit. It might not. It might, you know, but what they really need is they need healing.
Mm.
And they need to feel whole again. So that was one of the reasons. And the second reason is that, you know, in our own lives, so Peter's father had committed suicide when he was 13. And, you know, you can imagine for any of us out there, and suicide is becoming more and more common.
Mm-hmm.
But back then, you know, it was just an absolute tragedy. And as a 13-year-old kid, that's something that's pretty hard to read.
Lots of process. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. And, you know, back then they didn't have lots of therapy and therapists.
Mm.
And then my own background, you know, my parents and grandparents are Holocaust survivors. Right. So, you know, that's a multi-generational trauma that probably most Jewish people have in their cellular, you know.
Yeah, their epigenetic makeup.
Yeah, that's right. So it is part of our epigenetic makeup. And so we both had things that, you know, we had, you know, met and we wanted to deepen our relationship. And there were things that were standing in the way, I guess, to some extent. And so we thought, well, what's going to, you know, what's going to give us the potential to even deepen our relationship and for us to be of greater service to the world as well?
Hmm.
And so it was just by chance that I was reading a Tim Ferriss blog, and, you know, many people out there will know that Tim Ferriss is an incredible supporter of psychedelic therapies, and he's gone through his own battles with depression and anxiety. And so I happened to be reading his blog. He said he was investing, you know, significant amounts of money in studies at Imperial College, who are one of the leaders in this space around the trials for psychedelic medicines. And so I clicked on the article, which was an article by Michael Pollan, and it was called The Trip Treatment, and it talked about, you know, how various people had been healed through these medicines. And I read it and I said to Peter, we really have to try this, you know. And so we were going to Europe that particular year, and we managed to, well, I tried to get us into the medical trials at Imperial College, and I could, because we're, you know, we don't actually classify as, you know, treatment-resistant depression or whatever it was. And so we ended up finding a private guide, and so we were able to do this in the Netherlands where, you know, these medicines are legal. And, you know, it was, yeah, absolutely one of the most meaningful experiences in our lives.
Wow.
It helped us to connect not only more with ourselves, it helped us to connect to one another and others in our families and the communities and to the planet. And it helped us to, we thought, well, we have an obligation to bring these medicines to the world, to make sure that these medicines are available to all the millions of people who are suffering. And we're not the only people that have experienced that. There's many, many philanthropists out there who've actually experienced these medicines, and there's many philanthropists around the world who are now investing their capital to make sure, and the talents to make sure that these medicines become available. And this is critical. Like, I mean, many people consider psychedelic medicine as one of the next frontiers for major transformation of humanity. And personally, I believe that these medicines are going to be transformational, not just for our mental health, but for helping us to heal the planet in a number of other ways.
It's an amazing conversation to be having, and I really respect, you know, thank you for sharing that, you know, there's your story and Peter's as well in and around that. And I think there's, yeah, I think it's not lost on me at the moment that, you know, like the, again, you know, finding your own creative expression and then learning to find service with your creativity is something that, you know, is really, how do I put this without aggrandizing you? But legitimately, you've done an amazing job of, like, you know, what is possible with creativity. And then obviously making that into a service-oriented sort of creativity, right? Like, it's been...
That's right. And that's the beauty, I think, of people finding their unique voice. So when people are able to unleash their creative voice and the full potential of their creative, acknowledging that we are all creative, you know, artists from an early age, and it's all waiting there for us to re-unlock it. It's not like, it's not permanently locked away. So our creativity is a is an innate part of our humanity, which is unfortunately for many people has been suppressed. So actually interesting study done by an academic called Cobus Needling that showed that 3 to 5 year olds exhibit 98% creative behavior, reducing to just 2% by the time we're 25.
Wow.
So there's all these environmental factors. It can be everything from family, education to just school, society itself.
Education. Yeah, all of that. That's
right. So, but it's all waiting for us to unlock our symphonies, our concertos, our recipes. You know, and a lot of people think that creativity is, you know, a ballet or I'm a poet or I'm a singer or whatever it happens to be. But actually we can express our creativity through so many different ways, and it doesn't have to be about art per se. It could be cooking. It could be solving problems is creative. And most people in their jobs solve problems, or even in their families. They're solving problems for their children. You know, we could all solve problems for our environment. There's so many ways to be creative. It's not just an artistic thing. But, you know, getting creative and finding your creative voice is much more than our singing voice. It's our sense of meaning and purpose and service in the world. And once we start to find that creativity, we then start to want to share. Usually, you know, we want to share that, right? And we want to connect with others. Mm. And then we're able to think about, well, how can we be of service? Because if you've got a talent, whatever it happens to be, and we all have a talent, you know, most of us have multiple talents. They're just unexpressed. Mm. And once we find what it is we're truly passionate about through our creative voice, then we're able to also become of service. So when Peter and I first did the plant medicines, we were just doing them for ourselves. It was just for our personal journey effectively, because we wanted to actually heal certain broken parts, damaged neural pathways or whatever it was. And incredible thing about these medicines is that they bypass the default mode network of the brain, reconnecting neural pathways that have been damaged and creating new neural networks. That's called neurogenesis, or increased neuroplasticity, which is so important for us as human beings. So with that increased creativity, because, you know, when we're depressed, our neural networks are actually very limited. They're very rigid. We're going around the same loop saying, I'm not good enough. Life's never going to work out for me. I feel ashamed. No one loves me. You know the sorts of, I know you know what it feels like to be depressed. So that we have these rigid, looped thought patterns. Mm-hmm. But when we have the intervention of, say, the psilocybin, or it can be the singing or the breathing or whatever it is that reconnects our neural pathways, the meditation, then we have our neural networks reconnecting. Mm. And new ones being grown. Our brain is incredible. Mm-hmm. So when we experienced these medicines, not only did we heal, but we went, well, we have to make sure that these medicines are available to all these people who are suffering. And how are we best going to do that? We're going to set up a charity.
Right.
And we're going to invest our money and our talents to bring together experts in this field, and psychiatrists and doctors and psychologists, because we're not doctors. Mm. And we're going to use our talents to set up a charity that is going to make sure that these medicines are available, certainly in Australia, and, you know, now reaching out to the Asia Pacific, because we're now setting up a global summit in November. We're setting up therapist training so that we can make sure that, you know, psychiatrists, doctors, psychologists, drug and alcohol counsellors can learn how to sit with these medicines and sit with others to help heal them. Mm. And setting up a centre of excellence so that we can further research and develop these medicines and potentially even make them available in Australia through creating an agricultural manufacturing facility to make sure that they can be grown in Australia so that we don't have to get them from overseas all the time. So there's all sorts of things that we can do. And it's just once you start to feel like, well, I want to be of service. And by the way, actually, Amrit, just going back to your breathing, your meditation and so on, when I was in my darkest place, which was probably about 12 years ago, so I'm no stranger to feeling depressed or down, and I went through a very, very difficult breakup. And I went to India with a guru, or meditation teacher friend of mine, and we worked with a guru in India who was his guru. And a huge part of that retreat was not only the meditation. Yeah, we used to sit for hours on a cold stone floor and meditate. And we used to watch, you know, these cows. Every morning they decorate these cows because the cows were the sacred animal.
Yeah.
But we also used to do acts of service every day.
Mm.
So whether it was feeding, you know, like lines of hundreds of people who basically wouldn't have been fed that day. So we'd be feeding them on banana leaves with rice or whatever it was. We'd be donating our money so that they could get sewing machines to grow, grow their own businesses so they could sew. And whatever it was that we did, it would be a combination of meditation, breathing and service every day that I was there in India. And so by the same token, you know, whatever it is that is our particular talent, you don't need a talent even. You just need to breathe, be mindful, be present, and connect to yourself and others, and then you'll find what it is that you are here to serve.
Mm.
Become generous.
Yeah.
I mean, this is not just about healing your own, you know, stuff. This is about, once you heal your own stuff, you're going to want to help other people.
Hmm. I've got a bit of a personal question. So there are quite a bit of challenges in this space in terms of where you're walking, in terms of creating multiple charities, right? And, you know, a serial entrepreneur, that is very much your MO. You've created a lot of things. There's, you know, again and again, you know, like, and this is just one example of many of the different ventures that you've created. You've managed to consistently look at where most people would potentially see challenge and move towards it and through it. Mm. I think it is about yourself that has helped you on that journey.
Look, I think it is, you know, I think it is through my grandparents and my parents. So, you know, the fact that they went through the hardest of times in human history.
Mm.
And were able to survive, and sadly, you know, the majority of my relatives didn't survive.
Mm.
We now have a very small family, whereas we could have had a large one. And so the fact that they got through that, that they managed to re-establish their lives in Australia, starting from nothing, and a lot of it was through the art and through the creativity that they were able to do that. So my grandparents, my grandfather was a famous sculptor. My grandmother was a painter, an art teacher. You know, she invented the foldable umbrella. My mother also is highly creative and used writing a lot in her life. And also, you know, being the daughter of a sculptor and artist and keeping their heritage alive through the Dordig studio. I mean, these sort of things are formative for me. And so they've enabled me to be resilient and to bounce back from adversity. And I've seen the power of creativity in their lives to survive. And that's really what's helped me to set up these charities now. And I feel like so blooming lucky to be here.
Touch with, yeah.
Like, this world is, you know, if we're born into a human incarnation, you know, if we're here experiencing, you know, there's lots of negatives in the world today, but there's so much beauty still. There is just so much beauty in nature, in just the love between human beings when we can experience that. There's just so much to be grateful for. And so I feel an absolute, like, and it's not a hard obligation. It's like, I feel like I love giving to other people and helping them to feel better and to find their true self. It's brilliant. When I see it in the choirs and see the light come into people's eyes and see them heal, it's magic. When I see people that have gone through these medicine experiences and often very highly conservative people. And look, my husband and I, you know, like husband in particular, comes from a very conservative banking background. You know, when you see people going through these medicine journeys and coming out the other end healed, it's like, it's a miracle. Every week in my choirs, when I see people who've been healed and then they start giving to other people in the choir because of their own healing, that's transformation right in front of my eyes.
Mm.
What could be more joyful?
I love that. The thing that's really settling in for me in this moment is the, like, and maybe this is really obvious to some people that are listening in, but for me it's quite a, just the way you're distilling the fact that creativity has the ability to help you combat change, to help you build resilience. The fact that creativity is a tool for resilience.
Yes.
Is a very interesting conversation.
It is. Well, my grandparents would not have survived without that. There is no question. Like, my grandfather actually bribed a border guard to get them the three passages out to Switzerland by sculpting his bust. So if he hadn't had that skill, he wouldn't have got out. My grandmother, you know, used her creativity, her creative mind and strategic foresight to make sure that all of the art was saved and stored in a Paris, you know, basement for decades. There's, you know, it was creativity that has helped me every single time that I've hit a wall in my life. Write a song, write some lyrics, write some poetry, write in my journal, express how I feel.
Yeah. And even creatively coming up with mental models and philosophies that support your existence and your relationship with reality, you know, it can be as existential as you need it to be, or as grounded as you said, you know, like sculpting to get your way through border guards. Like, it is, yeah, it's quite a profound, that's, sorry, that's a massive takeaway for me. Just sharing. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Well, it is for me as well, actually. I mean, like, it is, because, you know, creativity is actually a form of survival and thriving. So once you use creativity to survive the hard times, then you can then use it to thrive, then you can use it to become generous and of service. Because once you've got through your hard obstacle, and you will get through it, and you come out the other end, you feel a greater sense of light and purpose. It's from that place then you can give to others.
I love that. And so what's inspiring you in going forward? Obviously, there's the charity with the many charities that you're invested in. But 2020, what is, you know, where this is a fresh new year that's ahead of us.
And a fresh new decade.
Yeah. Oh, there's so much to be excited about. What is, what's exciting you the most about what's coming forward?
Look, yes, I'm really excited about Mind Medicine Australia and where we're going with that. It's moving incredibly fast, which is necessary, and because there's a lot of suffering out there. So I'm excited about that. I'm certainly excited about the With One Voice choirs. We've now got 30 around Australia, and we're heading to a target of 40 by the end of 2020.
Awesome.
So that's really serving a lot of communities and joining the dots for people in those communities to come together and build social cohesion and social inclusion, and, you know, weekly miracles through the With One Voice programs and the wish list that I spoke about. And then for me personally, it's about sharing my voice more with the world through my singing, my speaking.
Yes, please.
Lots of keynotes all over the world, lots of concerts and singing. I've just released a new album, which is called The Breezes at Dawn Have Secrets to Tell, which is a wonderful Rumi poem, actually. But so it's a wonderful new album that I've just released literally just this week that combines, you know, some of the poetry of Rumi and Khalil Gibran and others with original
favorites.
Lyrics. And I recorded that in California with some creative colleagues over there just a few months ago.
Awesome.
But just, you know, I want to use my creative voice, because I often get so caught up in, again, you know, and you can do, you're helping others and setting up these charities and things, but I also need to go back to
fill up your own cup. Yeah, it's a deep lesson, that one. And somehow we only really realize, oh, whoops, we've been filling up other people's cup when our cup starts to, yeah. And it's like, oh, whoops, yep, get back, align.
I have to keep remembering to go back to that and giving myself time and having enough self-care and self-love that I can go back to what really renews me and restores me and is able to, also helps me to reinvent all the time.
That's amazing. And so for those that are tuning in that want to get in touch with you, the best way to do that would be, or to find out more about the choirs, to work with my medicine, is it taniadejong.com or what is the best place?
There's a couple of, so taniadejong.com, taniadejong.com. But actually, so two other websites worth looking at is www.creativeuniverse.com.au. So that houses a lot of my different enterprises, but then mindmedicineaustralia.org is the other one that I'm sure people will want to go and have a look at and get involved and learn and share this message of inclusion and healing so that we can all find our creative voice. Because, you know, together we can change the world one voice at a time.
Oh, Tania, thank you so much for coming along again, doing this all over again to share your wisdom, your insights, and just, you know, what is possible with creativity. It's really, really potent. It's not just the content, it's also the context in which, you know, you diligently work on to cultivate that message and be able to share that with such profoundness with us all. So thank you so much for all of that and acknowledging not just today, because obviously you've just dropped in, but all the energy and work that it takes to actually build that context to be able to make the content so impactful and empowering for us here today. So thank you so much for your walk, and as always, wishing you the best on what's coming up. And to you
and all your listeners.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Find your voice.
Thank you guys so much for tuning in to the Love of the Inspired Evolution and sharing the Love of the Inspired Evolution. If you feel like this content has supported you or may support anyone else that you know may resonate with the content of it, please share away and share the love around. Thank you guys so much. And to stay up to date on whatever's coming out with the Inspired Evolution, please subscribe. There's all these links in the bio for you to tune into the episodes and all these different platforms, just so that message can get to you and your loved ones. Thank you so much for all your love and support. Stay inspired to evolve.